$1,043.95. So we'll send back $1,956.05.
I make a motion for solid waste to send back $1,956.05 back to the energy and environment.
You don't have to check with the state director.
That's it.
I second.
We have a motion and a second. Any questions or discussion? Ms. Brandon, you call the roll.
Ms. Axelrod?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes.
Mr. Blackwell?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Mr. Roberts?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Okay, we were very fortunate in securing our household hazardous waste grant request for $22,000. I hope to have that sometime in September or October.
Again?
Pardon?
You said that thing again?
No, this is the first time, this is the very first grant that Boyd County has ever received for this, so I've got to be real careful where I have it because the company that I'm dealing with, there's a good possibility we're going to slam the feet of Boyd County never had one. And it takes, I've got a company out of Cincinnati that I'm dealing with, bringing in a chemist along with six or eight other people. And you all, I will be asking you all to give me the right to shut it down. I'm going to keep it under $20,000. Grant's $22,000. We have to match 20 or 25% of that, so we will be under $20,000. I just need permission today for the judge to sign the grant agreement, and I'll get that in the mail tomorrow. And then I'll keep you posted on that as we go forward.
You will put that in the paper?
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Is that one for refrigerators that's got freon in them and paint cans?
It's more, it's technically more for lead acid paint, herbicides, mercury, anything. But I think as far as the refrigerators, I've got to check on that. I'm not sure on that.
Okay, motion is requested for me to sign the paperwork, correct?
That's correct. Household hazardous waste grant.
Is that your motion or do you want?
No, I'll be motion.
I'll make a motion.
Thank you. We have a motion. Are there a second? We have a motion and a second to give me permission to sign the household hazardous waste grant. What is the $22,000, Larry?
Pardon?
Is it $22,000?
Yeah, total of grants, $22,000.
Okay, and I want to congratulate our solid waste director for applying for this. Court of Ashford, applied for. I want to congratulate you for winning this because this is the first time Boyd County has had a house. That's hard to say, a household hazardous waste grant.
HHW.
HHW. So thank you very much, Larry.
Thank you all for having confidence in me. You're the one of us.
And Rick, you know, if there are no questions or discussion?
Ms. Axelrod?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes.
Mr. Blackwell?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Mr. Roberts?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Okay, let's talk about the cane dump just for a second. We have depleted our funds and it is not clean. So I've been asked by the state to bring in the state environmental people. And we're going to meet down there with Morel Environment, or all our excavating, which is Morel Environment. And we're going to decide as what direction we need to go because there's a whole lot more than what we anticipated, and I probably in fact going in this, so I was on the phone with them last week, or this week, and the EPA people are supposed to be this week, and send a crew out here, and we're going down there and meet. We still got a large amount of junk.
You don't have any junk, you don't?
No, but I'll let you know. Judge, do you want to do the roadside garbage now?
nonprofit organizations such as Boy Scouts, and there's another nonprofit that's requested money.
Baseball, beans. Basketball, any, baseball.
We're looking to do that, we want to wait for that.
Judge, it's on me.
Oh. Thank you, Judge, whatever.
It's just, it's a real simple program. It's to spend your litter, that's the litter of funds, gives you a little more avenues to spend. What I would do, if it's a nonprofit organization, let's say the North Florida basketball team wants to clean up 2 miles of the road, we would pay them $100 a mile, both sides of the road, and they can put that by uniform orders. A lot of the county, that's how they spend their litter funds. But we've never done that here, when Jeremy used the inmates, and that worked out well for the last couple of years. I had a couple, organizations ask me, and I don't mind trying, it's a little more work on me, but if you all don't mind trying, we can try it, see how it works. A lot of the county's good. Not the only thing I will buy them, and the sheriff's department, Mr. Cook is gonna go over with me a little bit on if we find a mess, anything to do with that, if they ever leave it documented. And I'll go over that with any of the nonprofits. It's just a way to kind of help the kids and family raise more money.
Oh, we got three to sign the paper?
No, I would just need your all approval, and then you would be approving what I sent you.
When will this be available, these funds be available out there?
Funds here now. We've already got our, my litter abatement runs from January to December. It's not like your all fiscal year. So we've already received 70,000 this year.
If someone comes and wants to, they're, just say it's a football team.
Right.
To do that, do they contact you?
Yeah, we're gonna start with me, yeah. I might find that all I'm good about. But yeah, when they get done, they can take it over to the recycling center and drop it off, and then I'll sort it. It's just a way to get the roads cleaned up and help the kids.
Now, they'll need sponsors or supervisors?
Oh, absolutely, yeah, we're gonna have at least two to three supervisors, and I will furnish them a green vest, maybe some gloves, that'd be all, and we can pay for that out for the rest. And I'm gonna track the jail with the road department and see where, what we're spending, how we're spending. A lot of that money we spend is, it shows, like last year, we spent $127,000 on paper. You didn't actually spend that, but we can write off $14 an hour in cars, and we can write off different things to get, to make that $72,000 spent. Legal, everything.
$100 a mile, is that an average?
That's the average what most counties pay, that's pretty cheap, you know, to get a mile both sides cleaned up.
Here.
He was talking about, Larry's talking about, it's kind of left over from a meth lab or something. I myself personally wouldn't know what it would look like. Kids who go out there, there's certain, somebody gonna be with them that know, don't touch it.
Well, I'm gonna, yeah. Now, I gotta wait in this, so this ain't gonna happen in the morning, but yeah, they're gonna know enough about it if they find it to call me. And they do, yeah. Or.
Yeah, I was gonna say, our drug task force is north of Larry, and we give them some training on what to look for, what to collect, what to do.
Larry, is there any liability to the county, to the job, or the work, on even this? There's a lot of bad insurance, but I have to present that.
What?
Insurance.
Yeah, and also federal ID. Right.
I don't need restrictions on certain roads, like, because it's not a kid's here.
Yeah, I'm not gonna put a kid on board for reason. Yeah, I want me to take care of. No, I'm gonna, I will keep them definitely on county roads. But you know, you have a lot of roads, like Heaton Lane. You know, you have a lot of county roads that are not bad. you know, there's a lot of county roads, a lot of y'all probably don't exist. Community been cleaning, and they're kind of very little traffic on. No, they'll just have their safety vests with their people and things, yeah.
Yeah, it just says Girl Scout leaders, the option that we go to, is the leaders gonna have that training provided, or they're gonna get, basically, that training for the, to identify them?
The way these other counties are doing it is, you know, you, the people doing it have to accept, accept a little bit of the responsibility. They accept a whole lot of responsibility. But I will advise them, when I give them the vest, spend 30 minutes, 45 minutes with them, and tell them what to look for, and what, and if they have any questions, they can call me on my cell. You know, I'm gonna work with them real close, we get this thing going, see how. And if it don't work, then we'll just have to quit doing it. All, every other county's good, so I don't see why Bull can't. Kind of how I wrap it.
Any other questions about this? When do we, does the sport need to do anything today?
I would just like a motion to go ahead and give the permission to start the roadside garbage pickup.
I make a motion to start the roadside pickup.
And do the job, but you're.
I'll second that motion. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion or questions on this motion? And Ms. Brandon, may I call the roll?
Ms. Ashwell?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Glassman?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Ms. Roberts?
Yes.
Motion here.
Any other questions? I'm out of here.
Okay. Number five, magistrates. Really, do you want to say anything about our avenue before?
Our avenue was something I didn't know anything about till probably last spring. And what it is, it's a road that runs off of Brooks Road. I think it's one of them. Anyways, from 65 over to the railroad tracks going to Brooks. It's a little road before you, right before you get to the railroad tracks. And we're gonna be putting in sewer lines there. And there is a gentleman that's going to, there's going to be state funds, and also there's a gentleman that's going to come in there, and he's going to help. They are taking the, they either have already done or are going to take financial status of each one of the people that live out there on that road. And if they do not have the funds to run the sewer from the road to their house and hook it and to pay to have it hooked up, then this gentleman that's, he's with a private entity, but they get paid somewhere out of that state money also. So then he, they will run it right to the house hooked up. So when we were meeting with that, then he decided that he would add on the Big Valley Sewer project also. And then he would help them in the same respect if they can't pay to have new lines, which I feel like there's a lot of new lines going to have to be replaced. I think because the new didn't work for so many years and was putting out raw sewage, that these people had unhooked their lines, that their commodes and things was not working, and they unhooked the lines on the trailer, it's all just been. So we got to find out exactly how much, how many people that's going to be. But he's going to go in and also help them to be able to get the lines that they need, get it hooked up, and run to their house, and then they'll have to put it up. Set the system, and it will go into the lagoon where it will be cleansed, the water going out will be treated. And so, but we're not quite there yet. We still have to have money from the state. They have, we don't know exactly all the ramifications from not having it yet, but we are, we have to approve for the money from the state. So that's what we're just waiting on. We've done some over here around the lagoon. They have a very high chain many things that's around there. They've done the farm, they've also done some build up around the overhaul and got all that stuff. But we still don't have the mowers and the aerators yet to be installed. So once we do that, before we do that, we're going to have a maintenance schedule. But it hasn't been approved, so we shouldn't have a problem getting it. So that's the reason we're not going to speak of that today, other than what I've just said, is because it's not done as far as money, and I don't want anything to get to Frankfurt and mess that up. So that's why we're going to discuss it over today. Thank you.
Thank you, Officer. Jimmy Miller, Ed Edgerton, Mark Arthur, Frank F.I. Powell, Judicial Center staff.
This is July, right?
This is July. It's been about 7 months.
I'm gonna walk slow, you might just lean back in your chair and take a break. I gotta say, you're nothing like what you are. Your camera is going.
Good afternoon.
Pretty close. Okay, I'm gonna bring up an issue that 3 weeks ago, I stood here and was talking about some strange looks from the manager. They had no clue what I was talking about. I was a month ahead of schedule, that's me, all the way. What I wanna bring up today, you got proposals in front of you for some step repair on the Oak County Judicial Center. We got four quotes in front of you, and I'm just gonna kind of briefly go over some of them, and I would have them because they go from low dollar to extremely ridiculous dollars. And the reason why. The one quote that we have from Leland Sandlin is for $8,950. That was back in March when I started doing this. We have an issue with the steps over there that are getting loose, and we started making some calls, having people come out and give us quotes. That's not an easy task. People say, yeah, we'll be right out. 3 minutes later, we're still on the phone, kind of getting to come out and do this. Fortunately, we did get some companies that were interested in it. Leland Sandlin came out, he gave us a quote on taking up what we have and just replacing it, putting it back properly. And that's the reason his quote is $8,950. Seemed reasonable to me. Since I had gotten his quote with dealing with other companies, a lot of what we have over there is not usable. It is damaged beyond the repair of just picking it up and putting it back. It's not like a concrete block. It is a man-made cast stone. It is a stone that is made in West Texas, which we no longer can receive. Nobody seems to be able to get it. So what we had to do was get some quotes here on what our alternatives was to make these repairs. So the sandwich thing, the $8,950, I think is something that's even reasonable for us to look at. So I called another company called Creative Concrete Solutions. Jordan Wilkerson. There's actually two quotes to this because he is a concrete company that does overlay. Okay. Overlay is a real thin mortar type product that they put over top of concrete. I personally have had some of this work done at home, but I don't have a good taste about it because I have a method here local, I guess, because he didn't have a clue what to do and I bought it out and out. But overlay, I talked to a lot of companies and kind of got a 50-50 wash on opinions about it. To do this overlay, we have to hire another company, which is the second part of this quote, to come in and take up all the stones. And what we're talking about here is the entire porch, steps, and mortar rail, everything. They have to pull all that up, just start it, come in for a 2.5-inch, 4,000-pound mixed concrete, basically on top of everything. And then they come in and put this overlay, which is up to a 4-inch thick, a special fiber product that goes on. The only good thing I can tell you about overlay is it's not a coarse, or a very coarse stuff like concrete or blocks. It doesn't let water in. Our biggest thing here is once water gets down in the concrete stuff, it freezes it. It becomes a hazard to all of it. It just starts popping the mortar out, the concrete starts contracting, things like that. Overlay is not a coarse product. Water doesn't sink through it. It has a barrier that just it won't penetrate. It's not to say it's going to crack, because if you have foundations, you can have them on some parts of the building, that stuff will crack. It is a product of real crack damage. As long as it's down, it's not going to let water in, and overall, I think it would be a good viable product and some things. I just personally don't think, my opinion is for us, I don't think it's a way, it's not a recommendation that I'm doing. The cost of that is having the stone that we now have removed and discarded, these people come in pour concrete and do this overlay, that total cost would run $29,663.50. That's the second quote we have. The third quote, unless somebody has a question on this overlay stuff, I'm getting very little information and my experience with it is not what it is. If not, we'll move on to the next quote.
Where did you come up with the 16,878?
I'm sorry, the what?
The 16,878.
Oh, that's the proposal on the other sheet here. That's for tearing out all the stuff. That's the demo. That's taking everything off of our building and pouring the concrete. That's okay. Actually a different concrete.
Okay.
And that's added to the 12,078. Okay, the next quote I have is from Hillside Fireplaces and Accessories. Well, now, this company here actually has done a lot of work in this area in Bull County. They did a lot of development homes. These people do fantastic. I mean, I've not seen anything that I thought didn't look real good. I mean, they do quality work. They're very high dollar. What he had quoted to us was also he quoted two ways, tearing out and relaying what we have. Well, he gave us that quote because this was before we come to the conclusion that we don't have it in the work. And what we have over there has rebar steel in it. These things are, some of them will have to be broken up to be taken off. To give us a quote for $15,000 to pull up and relay our steps and the border around the front porch there, as you can see. That's not a doable option for us. He quoted us on the second page. He quoted us the variegated color, the Indiana limestone. Limestone is what makes Kentucky great. We make our bourbon sale and everything else. So it's got to be good proportion, right? He's giving you two prices there in the land. What he's got is, he's got a material cost of $23,543.54 to have this limestone, cut limestone. Basically, it's what you see in the sides of the roads and things like that. It's cut down to the measurements that they need. And it will replace these man-made cast stones that are laying there now.
We've got the first page, so
$15,000.
I wasn't
going to throw you under the bus this time. Okay, well, I have it. If you just want to pass it down, I don't have a copy here. So I don't want to make it. It's got the two prices on it. Basically, to furnish material is that hot plate. To tear everything off of our steps, the board, and put the limestone back is the bottom part. So together it ends up with a total cost of $56,000 or something. That's a lot of dollars for what we need. But after looking at what this company has done out there, would it be worth it? Probably so. Is it something that we need? I don't think so. Okay. Seems like the limestone down and we can get a better price on it. We have another company, and I'm moving into that. Somebody has a question on Firestone or Hillside. Hillside has a lot of work in this area that they do. They specialize in smart plants, chimneys, patios, things like that. And there's a lot of new construction in here with their signature on it. That's really nice. Landmark Stone is our last quote. Landmark Stone come out and give us an option, a different option that I didn't think of. They have a price up there to remove and dispose of all existing cast stone steps, trips, and risers, and put it in pavers. And you approach me with the paver out here, and I thought, you know what, it's an option. It gives us something to look at. What he was talking about is if you look out behind you and see our sidewalk there, the actual red brick pavers, you can install those on these steps. And you can use a mortar base, thin set mortar to go down, polymer stuff that would to go in the joints instead of having stuff that's gonna freeze and pop out. It's more like what you'd see at a service station, at gas pump, those seams that are filled with the elastic type seals, not just a concrete board, so it doesn't feel expanded and cracked, it's not gonna crack and pop out because the water gets in. The pavers, again, I'm not a paver fan, but it looks good in some applications. I'm just beautiful building behind them. I don't know if it's what we need. I think we need what we have there now to kind of tie in with the external building. He also gives a quote of putting in the cut lines for it. So that quote that he had given us to do the insulation of the cut limestone is $18,200. And that's in lieu of the 4x8 paper. Now, he has an additional $2,500 down there for the reset of the cap along the outer rail. Those stones that you're looking behind you on the outer rail, those things are loose, but they don't have any foot traffic, and there's a rail to keep people from getting out there on it. But it's an issue, and they really need to be touched on. So to do that, and the railing and the reset point of all the joints is an additional $2,500. So the total cost of that would be $20,700. That will repair our staff on both sides of the porch, the border rail all the way around on the outside. And that's putting in a limestone replacing what we got. Now, limestone, what you're going to get is a shade's color, maybe not perfect match. Because when you cut it, it's going to eventually it'll all fade. Just like concrete. They will put it down twice, 10 years, it's going to look dark anyway. They tell you that over there to be dark anyway.
Is AOC
going to
be called in? I think what?
This is how we started back in March. We impacted so much in because they will get into the condition the same thing that we've done, so thank you for the little so this is more of a short term issue for the family and the neighbors to ask maybe the public hearing.
Do you want action today?
I would like to have it. My recommendation would be for Landmark Stone. I think at this point, this is our best bang for the buck here. I think this is the 20,700. Now that's really both sides of the building and the border around the outside.
Okay, I make a motion that we accept Landmark Stone Incorporated per Mike Powell's recommendation.
Yeah. Thank you for it.
Well, these companies only have to resubmit.
better bid, or do they think they've already?
Well, these companies came back in March, and of the companies we had, only one has come back to me at least three times. And I keep telling the same things, you know, the new fiscal year's coming up, it's July, but all these companies have contacted me several times, at least three times once. And calling back, I guess there's a chance, say, people do need to see, for example, some of these bids, if you look, say, you know, 30 days, 60 days, contacted all of them, said, did they have? All right, and that's all I have.
Well, see, next time.
Hopefully, I'll still have. I'm sorry.
Bill?
Paul, turn me out, what's, is it for Landmark Stone, I thought you said that was $15,000. Your $20,000, did you turn it out, what's there?
Yes, yes. Landmark Stone, that's the limestone, turn out what's there, the limestone.
I think the judge is getting ready to take a break before y'all reading, and I know perception is everything, I asked her, let me make a statement, this is definitely Lee Curry. The last regular fiscal court meeting, he came in here and served me with papers. He's here to serve me again, because that's what I knew about this process in the county. But there were some folks that last year, and I would have never thought that, but honestly thought I was in a lot of trouble, because Lee had waited on me to serve me. So I just wanted to make it clear, I just, he's just doing his job, and I'm doing mine. Okay, that's all.
All right, I'll make the motion to take a five-minute break, guys, gals, we will get to that issue on that, so we'll be back in a minute. We have a second, and hopefully, any questions?
Okay, hold it there.
Who had trouble?
I'm in a lot of trouble, but that's. I don't know, but they have some difference.
It makes it so much easier on me when you're here. Because I'm here, because I look back here and I see, and I'm close to you. You know, whether we agree or not, you're here, you're supportive. I'm giving you my security blanket. I know you do, I know. They always nice to me, which I appreciate.
Even though, you know, you're right, you're wrong.
Right, you're still nice to me. You almost come back.
I mean, I'm not always right, I remember back.
I have a bathroom. Are y'all staying or leaving?
I'm gonna leave, I'm gonna depart.
Okay.
Take care.
Okay, bye.
And everybody else is too.
Bye, Sandy.
I'm glad you're saying it.
I am too, I'm on my way.
I'm trying.
Hi, Mark.
Thank you. We think a lot of her. She does have her. But I have the time for a conversation.
Thank you.
And your family?
Yeah.
Hey, you get hungry, don't you?
I just want to.
out of old business, number one, second reading of ordinance 13-17, Deputy Sheriff, Mayor Board Creation Ordinance.
County attorney, are you ready?
I'm ready to wait.
An ordinance relating to the creation, operation, and authority of the Deputy Sheriff, Mayor Board Creation, pursuant to KRS 70.260 or 70.273. Be ordained by the fiscal court county of Willis, Commonwealth of Kentucky in summer. Number one, set forth the Deputy Sheriff, Mayor Board, here and after, board is hereby created pursuant to the provisions of KRS 70.260. Number two, set forth the board shall consist of five members, two appointed by the judge executive with approval of fiscal court, two appointed by the sheriff, and one elected by sworn deputies of sheriff of Willis County. Number three, sets forth that the term of each member shall be 2 years. Number four, sets forth that a chairman shall be elected at the first board meeting. Number five, sets forth that the board shall meet when a disciplinary matter regarding a deputy sheriff is brought to his attention or at other times at his discretion. Number six, sets forth that the position of deputy sergeant and lieutenant shall be subject to the authority of the board. Further sets forth the position of captain, and any position ranking above that of captain are considered policy-making positions and are exempt from coverage by the merit system. Number seven sets forth the board shall adopt rules consistent with the provisions of KRS 70.261. Number eight sets forth the training requirements of KRS 70.263 shall be met by all deputy sheriffs. Number nine sets forth that the board shall employ a chief examiner whose duties shall conform to the provisions of KRS 70.265. Number 10 sets forth conduct in which deputy sheriffs may not participate, including soliciting contributions for any political party or candidate for public office. Further sets forth that deputy sheriffs shall not be a candidate for a public office. Number 11 sets forth that the first year of a deputy sheriff's employment shall be probationary, and during that time, the sheriff may revoke employment at any time at his pleasure. Number 12 sets forth the disciplinary procedures of KRS 70.270 and 70.273 shall be followed. Number 13 sets forth the following particular revised statutes are incorporated by reference and attached to this ordinance. KRS 70.260, 0.261, 0.262, 0.265, 0.267, 0.270, and 0.273. Number 14 sets forth that the ordinance shall take effect and be in full force upon passage of publication. Number 15 sets forth that should any provision of this ordinance be found unconstitutional or invalid by a court of competent jurisdiction, all other provisions shall remain in full force and effect. Number 16 sets forth that this ordinance shall be self-corrective and shall incorporate any amendment made to applicable state law. Given first reading at the regular meeting of the Willis County District Court on the 18th day of June 2013. Given a second reading at the regular meeting of the Willis County District Court on this, the second day of July 2013.
Thank you, County Attorney Robinson. Action is requested.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
County Attorney, on section 13, these KRSs, Sunday GA, you know, I don't have online. Well, if that's the ordinance, would you want to copy now? I can have something for
No, I don't have to do it now. I just didn't know if I should change this before we go on.
Change what?
Well, these KRSs, I got a KRS 261, and my next one is 263.
It says 260, 261, 263, 265, 267, 270, and 273.
Richard just reminded me, so let's take the public comment first, and then we'll proceed on the motion. Okay, anybody want to, does anybody want to speak concerning this issue?
I'll speak real quick.
Okay.
I'm Freddie Boyd, Board Hammer College. Now, I stand up.
I'm sorry, Paul, hold on just a second.
In ordinance for the county, the first reading is not a public hearing, it's your second reading. The planning and zoning, the first reading is a hearing.
Okay, I understand that, but it's very confusing. Okay, go ahead, and your title is?
Again, I'm gonna take it before we go to the little hammer out of the bid. I say that in front of your families every day, protect your family members, people I don't know. This is a really good tool to protect me from my brothers and sisters. It kind of takes our jobs a little bit, what we do. And I think that's a lot of times that's pushed to the back, we're kind of people that run in the back and fall, it's in the night, you gotta come see us every day. It means a lot to us when we do that. It protects our jobs, our families, our loved ones. We do it for you guys every day, whether you see it or not. You don't have those you don't know, have those you've never seen. Is that all I have to say?
Would anyone else want to discuss my?
I certainly support the mayor, I think it's a very good thing, very good for the officers, and very good for the county.
I'm gonna call one of our deputies out, Billy Allen, if he'll stand up. I told you all about him a couple of weeks ago, he was who we sent for recognition expert, he just got back from training, we don't have his results yet, but hopefully he will be Bullock County's first DRE expert.
Anything else, any comments? Magistrate Ashley, you want to proceed?
I have a motion to pass the ordinance number 13-17.
I'll second it.
We have a motion and a second, any questions or discussion? Here it goes, Mr. Grant, and then call for it.
Mr. Ashley?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Ashley?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Mr. Roberts?
Yes.
Motion carried.
Congratulations. You're welcome to stick around for the rest of the story while we want to leave. You're not spared, so you're welcome to stay, tell me what you do. Okay, we have presentation under new business number one, presentation of the Bullock County Sheriff's Office Tax Settlement. No action is required. You have to accept it.
It's a set in the record, Judge.
Okay. Okay, action is requested to accept this into the record. We have a motion and a second, any questions or discussion? And Mr. Grant, the call for it.
Mr. Ashley?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Glassman?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Mr. Roberts?
Yes.
Motion carried.
Thank you. Number two, under new business, presentation of the Bullock County Sheriff's Office Audit Report for year ended December 31st, 2012. Do we need actions?
I don't know what I'm gonna do.
Is that in the record, Judge?
Just accept it into the record, that everybody has received it and all their other things accepted into the record.
So we don't need actions, we don't need both.
Yeah, we don't need both of the rest.
Perfect, and fine. We're gonna get through the motion.
Make motion to accept the Bullock County Sheriff's Audit Report for the year ending in December 31st, 2012.
Second.
We have a motion and a second, any questions or discussion? And Mr. Grant, the call for it.
Mr. Ashley?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Glassman?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Mr. Roberts?
Yes.
Motion carried.
Number three on our agenda is presentation of the Bullock County Clerk's Office Report for the year ending December 31st, 2012.
action is requested, except anything better. We have a motion and a second, any questions or discussion? Ms. Axelrod?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Blaisdell?
Yes.
Mr. Blaisdell?
Yes.
Jeff Roberts?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Number four, under new business, action is requested to amend ordinance 11-09, the Bullitt County Administrative Code, Chapter 7, Procurement, Section 4, small purchase procedures, item B, increasing the amount from $1,000 to $3,000.
I discussed this item with Deputy Judge Pratt the other day. Plus, just to discuss with my judge, this is going to have to be done in the form of the ordinance for the first reading, effective reading and all that. So we can't really do this today. But there's some provisions that need, not only need to change the IDB, you need to change that in A, to make it proper. So I guess we need to, table this or skip over it until the proper paperwork is done.
Well, the administrative code is an ordinance, so it has to be amended to an ordinance. You built into that a mechanism to review it by June 30th every year. You can amend it at any time. You just need to tell me what you want those amendments to be. I don't know if they're limited to this section. If you all looked at the entire administrative code, is the rest of it okay? Because if we're going to amend by ordinance, we need to do it all at one time instead of having, multiple amendments if possible.
So could we possibly go ahead and mark the print and come off? Can we go ahead and vote to amend ordinance 11?
No. You have to have a publication at first and second reading. That's why I'm saying if you've got more than this that you want to amend, now's the time. A very good time if we're going to rewrite the provisions to do it all at once, because it's quite a bit to amend an ordinance.
Okay. Moving on to the next item.
I don't really control the procedure of how the board is done. It's whatever you all want to do. But if somebody wants to send me changes, if you can just email me. The only thing I'm requesting is that if you want to change more than this, let's put it with nothing.
Thanks, Mark. Okay, if you all want to send your... My office will send this change to the county attorney's office from $1,000 to $3,000.
It affects more than just that provision. That's what makes it great.
I understand. But that's what my office is looking to change. I do not know what National wants to change. So, okay, if you can just go online, send this to the county attorney and the management district, what I told you, if you want to send your changes to the county attorney.
I'm not trying to change anything else. I'm going to pass it off with this crowd. Discuss that we should agree that changing IDB is not the only thing that's going to change.
Okay.
I'm not going to change my name to make it work.
Okay.
I'm going to use the
okay.
She's aware of that.
That's what Monica is saying, if the report has any other changes, we're going to have to look at documents. This would be a very good time to be changed. And I think that you have, I don't want to mark on the spot, I think Mark maybe wants to talk to you about the amount and see why 3 instead of like 5.
If knowing that I've got is, I don't know about the other departments, but in a maintenance repair situation, like these heat pumps, they're going to cost anywhere from probably $4,000 to $6,000 to replace either one of them at any given time. And they're at that age right now where one of the lights is going to start happening very often. From my own personal department, and I don't know how other departments feel about it. Lights in there, $1,000, you don't want somebody to spend for it and just get whatever I feel like getting in time. But that's on the outcome. I want to see about at least 5 minutes.
can jump in here just a minute. What he's saying is, it's not so much replacing the whole unit. We went through this last year with the $8,000 water source heat pump unit in the judicial center. We have 49 of those over there. And one department that the county attorney works out of on Wednesdays, if that air goes out, depending on what time of month or week it is, if I have to come in here just to get an approval on an $1,800, just a compressor, not the whole unit, well, there's almost a month with no heat in there. Well, they're going to have to pay it because, I mean, without air, you just can't stay in the room. So instead of putting it off 4 weeks, if we raise that amount, that would get those things like that. Because there's not much you can do in the, right now we're in the air conditioner. When we get in heat mode, it's going to be the same thing, just different. But there's not much you can do with $1,000. And every time you have to come in, depending on whether it's close to a port bay or not, it puts you back 2 or 3 weeks in whatever you're trying to accomplish. So we really need to bump that up. If that's the only change you're making, can this not be like the first week?
No, it has to be. The whole thing has to be printed
around the newspaper. There may be somewhere else besides the administrative codes who might be able to do something just for it. Means or buried or something, I don't know. I haven't totally read the whole thing, but I have used that particular part of it a couple times. It kind of handcuffs us a little bit where we can't, you know, go ahead and place that in a hurry without having to come here and ask.
Well, Lisa and I have discussed, Ms. Pratt and I have discussed, both of paragraph A up to 3,000. If you don't change that, you've got a gap of what you do with 2,000, it's not covered in the board. So, but you're saying you'd rather have it bumped up to 4 or 5?
Yeah, somewhere in that range. I was really excited to discuss that.
Okay, we want to move on to the next agenda.
You can't really table this specific item because it, according to the ordinance, it can't happen that way. So we just
we're just not helping y'all tell me whether or not you want.
So maybe.
And then we'll drag something together.
Just make a suggestion that the magistrate or anybody that has a suggested change to the administrative code, contact the magistrate, contact the judge's office. Within the same next 2 weeks, so we can get some of the
okay, John, I'm sure everyone heard that, so any questions about what Manager Gretchen has said? Okay.
About the next fiscal court meeting, we will give the county attorney instructions for the
motion. And that will be July 16th. Number five of the new business, action is requested on an order of allowance to the Board of Assessment Appeals.
Virtue of keeping the minutes and keeping records of it, and the two individuals are Ms. West and Mr. Rock are both appraiser or whatever, so they confer on these appeals. People want to file on their tax assessments. So they have been, that meeting is required by statute, and then fiscal court pays half of the salary, and then the state pays it. This is the request. This is a motion.
I make a motion to approve this order of amount for $750.
I'll second.
Oh, John, you're not adding the different motions.
And county judge executive, he's from his past, which he signed this document.
All right, we have a motion. Do I hear a second? We have a motion and a second. Any questions or discussion? Ms. Brandon, can we call the board?
Ms. Ashwell?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Blackwell?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Mr. Palmer?
Yes.
Motion carried.
Number six, under new business, action is requested on application and agreement for use of district property. Debbie Judge, you come this in.
I think Laura saw this with my huge work on it. It's basically, and I think Officer Cook, your comments. This is from the Board of Education. This is a document they are requiring. The sheriff's office to use that property for the concealed carry classes.
Okay, let's let Detective Cook answer questions or explain what's going on here.
Actually, the property actually belongs to Fort Knox. It's on the lease of the Willow County School Board. And that was used for ROTC and the 4-H program for the right to practice and the ROTC right. We use it for year qualifications, type of practice. It's also used for the CQW, sheriff's office, the school board asked me to have an insurance policy fill out and sign, but they're all also that there's an actor or something on their lot. And that's what that may look after.
What can you say to this?
I was over it yesterday. There's my standard for me.
Now, I believe it's something they didn't fill out and pay it off.
In case I've been notified, and that's what their own insurance policy.
So we can. You all have already been using.
Yes, ma'am. Probably.
So who's the standard?
It's at Beach Grove Road. It's a 50-yard gun range, 50 yards in front of the Knox.
Almost a 50-yard.
Actually, it belongs to Fort Knox. It's on permanent lawn, Fort Knox, to the Fort Kent School Board. And that drives to the York series.
Don't get too close.
We're good where we're at.
Okay. You know, I cannot recall ever having to sign something in the past. But that's just not my direction.
I think the thing in the past, I think Greg Boardmaster may have spoke last time, and I'm not sure when that was. It's something that brought my attention and said it is.
I think it's something. Jeff, we did sign something like this when Larry used the parking lots for the clinic days.
Uh-huh.
We had this sign. This is just something new that the Board of Education is requiring.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Gotcha. It's the Board of Education.
Yes, sure. Sure.
Which is what you called me a week ago. We'll go to the form that John just spoke about. Any questions or
Yes.
Mr. Lashaw.
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw.
Yes.
Ms. Harper.
Yes.
Motion carried.
Thank you.
Thanks, Corey.
Thank you, Mayor.
All right. Number seven, action is requested on employee salary report.
Yes, ma'am, this is the document, the treasurer would ask that we create something that the court can go on showing the pay raises for everyone. You know, we passed it in the budget, there were some people that received more than 50% across the board. So rather than going through each of those people individually, we just created this document, and Mike has given you one hundred.
Yes.
Things of parties, and I emailed the magistrates, well, I'm about to get on their desk, the board's bringing it in, and this is what I have for everybody else.
Well, so we don't have the other one?
Or is it, we want to do the words the same way, but this is just Mike's department.
Yes.
I emailed all the magistrates, one of my, and then the packet, but I told them I had a part on the other desk, and I'm about to get on there.
Okay, and this is so that the employees, our 200 employees, get their pay increase.
Yes.
Which was voted on last week in the budget.
Well, we passed the budget and we.
I know, but.
Yeah.
But the employees are.
But we didn't make an actual motion that each employee received.
Correct, because I remember clearly talking about that.
Yes, it was in the budget, it just.
Which I thought was okay, which I thought that was made okay. But it doesn't.
And so I said there were some that received more than 50 cents, so just actually get everything on record and clear transparent.
I think that's a jury. Action requested. What did you say?
I said, did my director put any more votes for me?
Ask him.
agenda. I make a motion to reappoint John Jer to the Mount Washington Fire District Board. His term expired on June, oh, his term to expire June 30th, 2020. We have a motion and a second. Any questions or discussion?
In the future, I'd like to have some input on these. I'll vote on this one this time, but I'll put some input in my area. Should I finish that?
Oh, absolutely.
Wow, very good.
I appreciate input. I think it's important that a lot of people can use it going over. Well, actually, it's a two-way street because, you know, you get the agenda, so you're more than welcome to not have any time and ask, who is this person? So it's time that someone wants to come.
He's a fine person, but I'd just like some input.
Sure. Well, just give him all, I'll be happy to discuss with you. Do you want that? No, don't scream at me. Just give me a call. I'm always ready to discuss things. And that's what we need to do. We're the two-way street. Any other questions or discussion on this rear document? And let me call.
Ms. Ashwell?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Lasso?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Ms. Robert?
Yes.
Mr. Carey?
And that goes for all magistrates here. I'm welcome. I'm willing to listen. More than that? I'm not willing to listen. Okay, Nichols Fire District. Nichols Fire District turned in their budget and so did Southeast Bullet. Thank you for the meeting.
I'm the recently voted president of the Grand Oaks Homeowner Association and the
that's in the city, it'll be more Bullock County on some of the road. We got notified by the Commonwealth Bank that they were no longer interested in keeping us for cover of our subdivision, filed bankruptcy a couple years ago, and they were stuck holding the bag, and now they handed it to us. So one of the questions that came up was, well, who's gonna finish the roads? Because there's a construction layer payment down, but there is no secondary layer to pay up and start the grade. So I said, oh gee, don't worry about it. Most places in the state of Kentucky require a surety bond to the developer that will be finished. I'm a licensed real estate broker in the state of Kentucky, and I've done business in almost all the surrounding counties. And so I said, don't worry about it, I'll go down to the courthouse and I'll find out who filed a surety bond, and we'll be able to get our roads fixed. So I go down to the going secondary state site and find out who the corporation is, and I come down to the courthouse and say, hey, there should have been a surety bond filed somewhere around 2004 for the construction of the subdivision and the finishing of the pavement. As you can see by what you just got handed out, Nelson County has theirs online, and this is the bottom of it. It says you will either do it or it has the surety bonds to file. Well, the clerk came back after 30 minutes looking, I couldn't find it either. Look, we don't see a surety bond filed for this subdivision or in this corporation's name, so that's interesting. But I did find through Open Records Act a letter from Mayor Jim Eads saying that the city of Hillview later on accepted responsibility of the roads. So then I was in City Hall in Hillview, and I said, talked to the clerk there, and so she called the city attorney Edison. Okay, so that, and he was on the speakerphone off and on as we were having a discussion about what was going on. And then he informed me that it's a very common problem in Bullock County that somewhere around 1998, somebody, and he didn't ever say who or what, I assume it's fiscal court. I don't know who could amend a document like this other than fiscal court. Removed that requirement from the zoning application. What you're seeing is the Nelson County zoning application, you see clearly it's on there. I don't know for a fact that it isn't on your zoning. I have not pulled the zoning application from the Bullock County. I will tell you, at the time that the subdivision was developed, it was in Bullock County, and then it was annexed in the W recently. So I guess my point to you is this. I'm not sure who took it off or who didn't require it, but I will tell you that left my subdivision holding the bag for closest ballpark estimate I've got so far is $147,000. I don't know who authorized that to be removed, some type of bond to be removed from the development. But according to Edison, Mr. Edison, that is a very common problem. There's several subdivisions in Mount Washington that have the same problem. So I don't know how big this problem is, but it's huge. And I can't believe it was. I'm hoping that somebody can review this and say, no, that really wasn't removed. And I keep thinking I'm dreaming this, that somebody would actually remove that requirement from development. So my request to you is, would someone please put that back in? And number two, if it's possible, develop some type of fund for the subdivisions that are having the same problem.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
This is a very common question, and you can give us an answer. First, this county's not removing a thing. We have a county road ordinance. If it was a county road that was being constructed in your neighborhood, you are required to have a bond after the time of the ordinance is in effect. Okay? I don't know when I'll be having to look out at your, they get the county road supervisor here and look at your area and see. If it belongs to the city, you're not subject to that. There's been nothing taking out, to my knowledge, of any of our planning and zoning rules. The Planning and Zoning Commission is a separate entity. Fiscal Court has an ordinance that requires the road bond, period. Okay? Planning and Zoning is a joint commission. It's made up of folks that's appointed by this board, as well as the cities. Okay? They have their own representative on it. So if the Planning Commission had taken any action individually, it wouldn't have been the court that did that. It's the committee that is part cities and part at-large appointees, people that don't live in the city, okay? Yeah. To my knowledge, you've been given some serious misinformation.
I'll be glad to see y'all go through it. Now, I'll use my own subdivision as an example. We're going to do the same thing. I live in the city of Mount Washington, but when my subdivision was started, it was not incorporated into the city. And they started it, but remember, the county had the requirement to have the road bond. The exact same scenario happened. And we all got left holding the bond, and before the city of Mount Washington would take it in, we had to have a final payment.
Yes.
That we all had to pay for. Because the rural county's ordinance requiring the bond came into effect after the subdivision went into place. And the subdivision at the time belonged to the county, wasn't incorporated. Unfortunately, this is what's happening. That's why many counties have now required a bond to be put in place. You just can't be retroactive. Because we all had the same thing. We paid exactly the same cost. We had folks coming here two or three times with identical scenarios. And that's why the county did take action to protect it, but it can only protect from that time forward. If it existed prior to that time, you're called the same catch 25 that I face, that many of our neighbors and friends would face. And there's no option. Now, I'll be glad to look at what you got and see if the city, you said you had a letter saying that the city did take it over. The city took that over, it's on them. Okay, and I'll be glad to look at that for you. Okay, with the county road supervisor, I just have to schedule a time for us to do that. Okay, this is the first I had heard about any of it. But I suspect that I get my control out.
Yeah.
And you probably fell into that.
Okay. I suspect you're correct.
Okay.
But I just want to make sure that nobody else gets stuck.
And there's a lot of people that's going to get stuck because I can't make our rules retroactive. Okay.
Yes.
The planning and zoning is not better way than anything. Okay.
Yeah.
I understand that. And I write letters to correct these statements between cities and counties pretty regularly. Okay. But actually, you sit down with the county road director because we'll have to go back and look at when that subdivision was started. Because if it was started under our ordinance, I can guarantee you that Jimmy would not have let it ever be started without a bond being put in place. Because I don't even call these folks because I can't give you advice that the bonds had lapsed or we sent letters and we tried to enforce all of those. And I gave them an update a few weeks ago on how many applicants are on.
Well, I can tell you that the city first filed the Secretary of State in 2004.
Yeah, well, we'll have to go back further than that. But once the city accepts the role, they accepted it as it is. That's why my situation, an example of the city of Mount Washington, would not accept until they had certified the final pay.
That's true for this person.
Okay. Well, then they haven't accepted it yet. They even said that it has to have a final pay.
Mr. Anderson, if you want, my office can get the director of the building department to use the office, call the county attorney, give them the calendar, and we'll set this meeting up with all of you.
Okay.
Is that you all right?
Yes, ma'am. Like I said, if nothing else, make sure that this is covered for a lot of people. According to Mr. Edison, this is a common issue in the county.
It's common if it existed prior to the ordinance. Because our ordinance is in 1990. I'm not going to call off on the end of the year because I'm not going to. If it existed prior to
the ordinance. Because I don't know if it didn't exist before.
Yeah, we'll look at it. Okay.
County attorney, once the developer takes a bankruptcy, won't he include the roads because aren't they using miles for the roads?
Well, it depends upon the nature of the bankruptcy, what they file, a whole bunch of factors. In my scenario, the exact same thing happened and the developer did file bankruptcy. And the corporation filed bankruptcy. You can't collect less from a terminal. Once there's no money, there's no money. And you had to fix it. Now, these folks can't create a fund to solve your problem because there's plenty of us that have been right there in that
group.
Okay.
Thanks for
the alcohol.
Thanks for the long time.
That's okay.
Thank you. Anybody else need to say anything? Taylor Austin, you have anything you want to bring?
I make a motion to adjourn.
I'll second.
Yeah, a motion and a second, any questions or discussions? And Randy, you call me, go, I'm a little person, this is closer. This is the motion to adjourn. And, Mrs. Edgewell?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Maxwell?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Motion carries.